morning, everyone.
Apologies for the confusion about the location. But now I feel that you have done some exercise, so you'll be fresh for this 3 or 4 hour long session. I think 3.5 hour long session. This is about test table development. But before that, let's do a basic introduction now for everyone. 3 things, your name, the current company and role, and if you have any experience with Agile or TDD. So I'll start with myself, Sanjay Kumar. I'm currently working with Agile as a trainer. And before that, I was working for Deutsche Bank, US, as Scrum Master and Developer. I have had, my total experience spans about 15 years with different companies, starting from TCS to Deutsche Bank before this current job. And in the past, last 5 years, of my experience, that has been progressively more and more agile, so to speak. I started on my own experimenting with JUnit and HTML and all those things, and I really wanted to work with agile, and finally I got a company which was actively pursuing agile, that was Virtual Time. So the last 2 years were truly agile experience, and we did all this to convert JUnit and continuous integration and all those things. I think it took a little more time than so let's start from here.
My name is Ashley Lemon. So today I am working in medical sector. I am doing some research. My experience is project.
Your experience is Java or any other system?
Okay.
Good morning, everyone. I am Yogesh Vats. Currently I am working in the field of media as a QA lead. And my total experience in Agile is almost 4 years, and I'm not into TDD or in development because I'm taking care of QA activities.
That's good, you still find something useful.
Right.
Hi, this is Ruchi Kalra. I'm with NIIT Limited since last 10 years and working as a project lead. Having good experience in Agile, but I don't have much idea about TDD.
Hi, I'm Disha Kamra. I'm also working with NIIT Limited from last 8.5 years. And my total year of experience is 13 years. And with NIIT, I'm working with multiple projects and I'm working there as a project lead. And yes, I know about Agile. I know the concept, little bit about TDD, but not the implementation.
I'm sorry, I missed your first name.
Disha.
Hi, I'm Richa. I'm working with Drishti Development, it's in Noida, and I'm working as a QA analyst with .NET experience, but not TDD.
Can you use someone
who knows Java?
Pardon, sir?
Can you pay you with someone?
Yeah.
For
this exercise.
Hello, I'm myself Saru, and I'm from MIT University from academics, and my research work is related to the project management, and currently I'm a beginner to Agile.
Good morning, everyone. I am Vikas and currently working as a dev manager in Atrium, which is in NSEZ. And from last 4 years, I am into Agile, and I am a CSM, certified Scrum Master. And means eager to know something about TDD. And in my technical background, I have a good experience in PHP.
Yes. Java,
no, it is with a PHP.
Hi, I'm Joy. I'm a freelance. Being a freelance, I don't need Agile or TDD. I work alone. I work alone.
But you need
Agile. I am Agile, and I work with test first in my head. But I don't need a setup like Agile with meetings and all that. I'm a programmer, I freelance. So there's nothing such as a freelance manager, I guess.
Okay, I would definitely like
so you can be a part of Scrum Master, I think, while going into TDD area. TDD is a
no, I think firstly, I would like to challenge the thought that you don't need TDD, but we'll see as we
I don't need TDD in sense of RG recording.
what we'll do is we'll go through TDD and let's first understand what is TDD, and then we'll. We can make sense of,
Yeah, my name is Arshia. I came from Hyderabad and I am a certified Scrum Master. I have recently did my certification and I am working as a Scrum Master presently at AJR Info Systems. And we are doing a project on .NET using Jasmine unit testing framework.
Okay, nice.
So I think this session will be very helpful for me to understand the framework and how the development cycle is.
Okay,
sir.
So are you guys experimenting with
GP? Yes, we are using that. But I'm not from the development background. So I think this session will help me understand few technical parts of it.
Sure.
My name is Mehboob Sharif. Mehboob Sharif. I'm working in the HR department. So I'm a fresher for this.
They want to use Scrum in recruitment.
Okay, that's good. So at least you understand the basic concepts.
Yes, I have explained him the basics. So he liked it. He said he will experiment it in recruitment and see how it goes.
Okay. So if you're not, have you done coding before?
I know SQL program.
SQL is useful for us or not? So this is a pretty picture of Agile, and this is not, it doesn't mean that Agile is messy. So it just, so yeah, there could be conflict. But the idea is, you know, there's a famous analogy of relay race with waterfall development and the rugby with Agile software development. Because with rugby, you know, people are moving as a team, passing the ball to each other. So that is the idea. So not the mess, but the collaboration. The process of coding, you know, good coding. So in traditional approach, you could say waterfall, and even in, you know, Agile, you could follow this approach of designing. So in waterfall, you design the entire system, and then you code it, and then you test it. But in Agile, people could still follow this routine of, you know, at the story level or feature level, you could design the feature, you could code it, you could test it. So that is the traditional approach. Pretty logical, right? In test-driven development, we try to work it around. We begin with a test, and then we code, and then we refactor if needed. Refactor or redesign.
Right.
We'll get back to this in more detail after some time. This is just a basic introduction. Okay, before that, let me take an example. I was working for a company in the health insurance sector in the US approximately 8 to 10 years ago. And I newly joined that company responsible for one particular application. And that application had some code which everybody, you know, was, most of the people were scared to touch. Because it was huge code, it used to work fine. So it was a working software, you can say. But the problem was, some of the, it was SPRTS, if some of you guys are familiar with that, SPRTS. It's MVC pattern based application. And and the problem was some of the classes, action classes, or some of the JSPs, they were like more than 1,000 pages long, 1,000 lines long. Some of the action classes were 2,000 lines long. So do you see any problem with that? You know, big code, everybody's scared to touch, but it works. Do you see any problem with that situation?
See, might be because if a person who is very new to that domain or be very new to coding also, so that person development speed may lay down because of not awareness, his non-awareness of that domain area.
Let me clarify a little bit. So it's not just that the classes were or the JSPs are 2,000 lines long. Mm-hmm. Some of the methods itself are like hundreds of lines.
Okay.
Right. Mm-hmm. So basically, the code was not modular enough.
Okay.
Right. So does it give more hints about the problem? What the problem was? I mean, you're right. Anybody else? Do you see any problem with methods which run into hundreds of lines?
I think management is difficult because if any change comes.
Exactly, and I would use the term for maintainability, right, which has different sections. Maintainability, so working software is great. Working software, that is the bottom line. Each piece of, you know, application or each piece of code should be working. as expected. That's the basic, you know, mantra of even Agile. But beyond working software, you also need a software to be maintainable. Has anybody worked on a piece of code where once you were done with that code, you never had to touch it?
No, it's not.
I could see two scenarios where it could happen.
Most of the times we avoid it.
Avoid it, but does it ever happen?
Cannot, because if our requirement comes, we have to do some change requirement and then do the change.
Actually, I have two examples. One is the field projects. If you do something, you don't never touch it again.
And
the second thing is features which are not used. So in the entire application, you may have some features. You once code and you don't touch it again. But for most of the code where which is getting used in the application's life, so the code is in production, it is actively in use, you will always have changes. And the changes do not come from problems or bugs only, they also come from requirements, because requirements change with time. So we have talked about maintainability. And in maintainability, number one thing is readability, right? And the other important thing is testability. It is difficult to test code or methods which are hundreds of lines long. So there can be so many permutations and combinations within one particular big method. So the idea is to write smaller methods, each method, and that will apply, I think, in everything. In PHP, I'm not familiar with PHP, but I'm sure, your PHP. In PHP also, you may have the concept of methods and all, right?
Yes, which
is in all the languages, the modular approach. So each method should do particular, you should have a particular responsibility. And you focus on that small responsibility, it's easier to narrow down your computation and combination.
Exactly.
Right? This method does this, it calculates less square root or something to find all the possible cases and then test it out. But if you have that particular case in a big line of, you know, big method, then different computation combination, this is mind boggling, okay, to cover all the cases. So, the question is, based on that approach, why not testing at the end? Testing at the end, it's very difficult to improve quality of existing code. Mainly because of two factors. One is complacency. Complacency means, you know, once you have written, let's say, waterfall where the entire development phase is for 2 months. You have written the code for 2 months, right? Now, there is a feeling of, you know, the happy path. Feeling that, okay, we have done it, you just test it daily enough, and then you want to move on. Right? Everybody wants to move on and finish the other work which is pending.
Mm-hmm.
That's one, complacency with what is already working. The other thing is recency. Recency in terms of, you know, human memory works in a, with recency. Recency is an important feature of human memory. You recall what has happened now. If you go to a hotel, when you stay for 7 days, and at the end of the stay, if they ask you how was the overall stay, that is fine. But if they ask you about food, what you ate on the first night, and if you like that food or not, it will be difficult for you to recall compared to what happened last night. So if the cycle is, you know, long, let's say 1 month or 2 months, and you have written all that code, and now you have to test it, you may not remember all the possible permutation combination of the first piece of code that you wrote. So the idea is to bring the testing development together. And the next point is similar, feedback opportunity is lost when you increase the distance between testing and development, then the quality of feedback that goes down. And the future state of project is difficult to gauge with time, right? And as we go towards the end of the project, when there are severe constraints of, you know, time, money, and resource constraints, usually testing is what is cut, because then you have to deliver something towards the end. I'll go to the next slide. Right, when there is huge project stress, there's less testing, because you are in that mode where project manager is shouting these things, just get it done with you, or come on, show me something. When you go into that mode of just getting it done one way or the other, by hook or crook, right, the idea is to bring something out. That is not the right type of testing. So the idea is to spread out testing during the entire phase of development into bits and pieces. Any questions so far? Or any example you want to share?
In our first slide, You have just shown us that TDD works with and it starts with a test, then code, and then reform or design. So without code, how can we means test?
Yeah, we'll see that. In the most likes, and I'll also work on an example, okay. And we'll show exactly how that can be done.
I have a question.
Yeah.
Means we write the test in first step, right?
Yes, yes.
So that would be unit tests or just a unit test?
Maybe unit tests. It's like it will cover exactly the point you're asking. So maybe I should move on. This is one. This is amount of effort you spend in testing, different types of testing. UI testing, service testing, and maybe together you can call it functional or integration testing. And this is unit testing. Unit testing is when you're testing the smallest piece of code, right? In traditional, what we talked about, where you design and then develop and then code, test, there's a tendency to focus more on the integration test. The thing is already done, so you're testing the entire piece. And the famous term that is used for that is black box testing.
Yes.
Your stuff is inside a black box, you're looking at it from outside and making sure all the cases are done. So you're doing it feature level testing, right, for all of the systems. And unit testing, you can say, is white box testing. We are looking inside the box, right? Your one particular feature could have multiple classes in all three layers, right? UI, service layer, and database layer, right? UI, service, and database, all three layers, you will have multiple classes. Now, you are actually going inside the code at each class level, and within the class, each method level, and try to test each and every method. Let's take a simple example, right? On UI, most of the UIs have some date formed representation, and there are different requirements. Sometimes you want the date to be month, day, year format, sometimes day, month, year. Sometimes you want the day of the week also, right? All the simple things. And somewhere inside the code, you will have a method that takes a date and returns a string, you know, user-friendly string expression. That's a very common thing. Somewhere in the code, you will have a method that takes a date and returns this thing. In unit testing, you write tests for only that particular method. And maybe multiple tests, right? You pass from 1st Jan, you know, first year of the month, last year of the month, last year of the year, all those permutation combinations you like to do and put it there. If there's another method that takes in, you know, day, month, and year integers and converts into a date, then you will do all different testing, including, you know, the failure testing of passing in 30th February, for example, right? All those things you can do at the method level. So that is unit testing. So when you focus, when you shift the focus, this is roughly 5%, roughly 10 to 20%, and mostly, you know, 70% in Agile, and especially in TDD, the focus is 70-80% unit test, and then service layer test, and then UI test. So what you're saying is not, we are not saying that this is not important or this is not important. We are just shifting focus, and you increase the focus more over here. It helps you reduce your focus here, because many of the tests, the code level, small little like UI kind of tests, they might be done at the unit level itself, right? And we'll see more benefits of unit level testing. For example, automation is one. I'm sure most of you are familiar with regression testing. So unit testing is a very simple way, because most of the unit tests, they are run in memory. That's a good, you know, best practice. They should be running in memory. They should not be going to database. They should not be going to UI. That's, for example, if you're doing testing MVC web application, there is a concept of mock framework, right, that help you simulate the database feature or the web feature, which you can pass servlets, you know, request response. Somebody talk about BDD, I think it was you. So BDD is very similar to ATDD, which is acceptance test driven development. The idea in both of these is the same. You first write the test, and when you write the test where you have not written any coding, what will happen?
What is the code for?
acceptance, test, remote work.
So what is the purpose?
So this is a more functional level thing, the black box testing, and this is the white box testing. So both help you achieve test first development. You're writing test first and then you're developing. And my question was, if you write test first before doing development, what will happen to the test? Will it pass or fail?
Okay.
And this is the integration of both of those, combination of how you can have both ATDD and TDD in the same project. You start with a story or feature, right? And then you write acceptance test for the story. So when you're writing,
I have a question. So can I say TDD is more successful for maintenance kind of a project, or the projects where change and enhancement or change and start coming very frequently?
TDD is useful for all the projects. All the projects where you have to code.
Okay. See, because looking into this slide, somewhere I'm able to visualize that. Suppose because when I'm writing a story, writing a user story will totally dependent upon what are the requirements which is coming to me for a development. So when I'm writing a story, when I'm writing the test cases, when I'm trying to implement the test cases, somewhere in the environment, that development environment, because I will be doing testing on some of the components only. Suppose I have an application form which is already there. Few of the requirements come from my client, okay, I need further enhancement in my application form. So I will those requirements will come as in my test cases. Okay, suppose that the application form is right now making only personal detail and professional detail. Now they want to enhance with the academic detail. So my user story and test cases will be trying to enter academic details. Of course it will fail. Now
yes.
So it's something like this.
So first, answer the first question is TDD or ATD could be used for all kinds of products.
So when I'm into very new product, when I'm supposed to develop a very new product, suppose a requirement has come to build an application, transferring that application form into a mobile application.
Okay,
so that will be a new. I need to develop or I need to.
So that is an entire application. Then you have multiple stories.
Okay.
And let's say the first story is the home page, right? If you're doing acceptance test and you're using, let's say, some tool to create your acceptance test, the first test would be go to this URL, right, and it will fail.
Okay. Right. So the very first,
that,
the very first code will come to me, he built that URL which will be, which should
yes,
work
yes.
in mobile.
Yeah, and this thing also helps with, you know, usually what happens if you have an agile team, you have developers, you have testers. Both have 2 week sprint. Right. The first day, what happens is testers do the testing, need to wait where the development is done. Within the cycle, they can start writing these tests, but it will start failing. First, they start understanding the story and maybe create their test cases, and then actually automate those test cases, and they will all start
failing. So it's clear, very clear to me now. Whenever a requirement comes to me, I'm actually supposed to write a test scenario, test story. Test cases, give it to my tester. What do you start with your testing and start giving your feedback to the developer, and side by side, he will start writing the code.
This is an ideal scenario how both could be combined, but there could be some challenges that you may have to, you know, tweak a little bit here and there. But the idea is to have, you know, testing first and and then development next. And the key reason behind that is it shifts your focus. If you're doing development first, there's a tendency to go on the happy path. This is what will work. If you're passing A plus B and doing some calculation, so you're always thinking about 2 plus 4 is this, blah, blah, blah.
Actually, you are right. It means that we face within our environment itself. We are into in-house development and are kind of standing at our head itself. And we are working into multiple applications. So client immediately comes to, okay, application of the SHR is the functionality, is essentially the immediate part. So of course we need to calculate the development effort, testing, unit testing, and then going for the UAT, and then aage sab kuch calculate karke uska deadline dena padta hai. So with this method I can tester aur developer ko saath saath, ya developer ko hi bolenge ki to tester ki tarah soch ke apna code likho.
So we talk about two three different things regarding that. Regarding somebody asking, giving the requirement, asking for an estimate, that will, if you're following Agile, that will come from story points,
mm-hmm.
right? So this is a story which is 3 point or 2 point or 5 point, and this is how much it usually takes to complete a 3 point story.
Because now I'm taking it, when I'm taking the requirement, those requirements say you just fill code for now.
So usually what happens, if you work on the development, design, code, and test cycle, your first pass gets done faster,
okay.
But then each bug you find later on,
yes.
It takes huge time to resolve.
Oh, I wish you got that.
Right. If you go through test, code, and refactor cycle, your initial effort might go up, but it will reduce so many bugs that will never come.
Very true.
Right. So it depends on if you want to show the first hour, what is the priority? If you want to show the first hour, or you want to show, create a product that has minimum number of bugs. Sorry, your part.
Yeah, I just want to add that while writing these tests initially, for writing these tests, both developer and tester should sit together.
Yes, I know that.
Yeah.
So, write a story means includes implicitly writing all the acceptance criteria. Writing acceptance test, then acceptance test. First acceptance criteria, then for each acceptance criteria you have acceptance test. Then you implement an acceptance test, and for implementing an acceptance, okay, these are all the acceptance tests. Then you implement one particular acceptance test, and that acceptance test would fail.
Yeah, because I'm thinking
we'll see. We'll actually go through an exercise and how that.
I want to know ki abhi to kya hai normal development ke baad testing hota hai, which lead into they are into fight. Ki okay bug to come hai, nahi ye bug hai, to raise bug ko resolve kar.
Wo to karna padega.
Wo conflict chahiye. Wo conflict kaise aayega?
Conflict ke upar we going into another domain of there's a famous book called Five Dysfunctions of a Team. So if you get the time, get some time, just read that book. It will have Five Dysfunctions of a Team. So take a look at it. It says this is a disturbance. One of the dysfunctions is lack of conflict. So the idea is conflict. There's something that will happen. You cannot avoid it.
It has to be. That's how.
If you avoid conflict, that's not a good strategy. Conflict will always be there. You have to, bring the collaboration up so the team resolves the conflict. It gets into the habit of resolving conflict. So getting back to this one, your acceptance test will fail. And then for implementing, for passing that acceptance test, you have to create the entire feature. For the entire feature, you need to have multiple classes. For each class, you need to have multiple methods. And then that lowest level of writing methods, you go on to this cycle. That is small unit test. Code, make it pass, then keep on doing that. We'll do a little bit of that in the second half. And then keep doing that until the entire acceptance test, this is passing pass. Right? That one criteria of the entire feature that is done. And then do it for the next feature, and the next feature, and the next feature. This is much easier to manage because it's usually one person, or if you're doing pair programming, it's two person sitting on desk and doing it, right? Generally, this one and this one combination is slightly difficult. So what happens in practical scenario is, in most of the companies, there's one person, an expert on, say, Selenium, Gutenberg, and all these things. They keep writing their list of acceptance tests for test suite while somebody is developing. And then, so instead of passing one, failing one test, you would have probably 10, 15 tests which are failing. Another way is, as he is progressing on his development, those tests begin to pass one by one. That's how it usually happens. This is the ideal scenario because it requires higher level of collaboration. benefits of TDD limits work in progress. That's the key main principle. I'm assuming all of you know about work in progress concept.
Yes.
And lean, you have heard about lean. And how is it limiting the work in progress? If you're writing the entire, you know, big piece of code and then testing it, this entire piece of code is undone. It's not done. Mm-hmm. It will not be done unless it has been tested. So instead of that, you are focusing on one method and then getting it done from your side almost completely and then working next one. Right? Ensure testing at lower granularity level. We talked about that. Ensure higher test coverage. No untested code goes to production. So if you are following TDD, you are creating unit tests. All these unit tests become part of a regression test. The test will not go into production, but the code that is going to production, it has been verified with lots of unit tests. Is that not clear? That's a very important point. Unit testing, in the small cycles, they are helping you create tests that will become your regression. Health high degree of conformity between code and the real business requirements. Because when you're writing tests, the point is not how to make it pass, the point is what does the customer want? What do you have acceptance criteria in the feature, at the feature level? So taking those things and taking little bit pieces of those requirements and then writing tests. It focuses on requirement, it focuses not on making it pass. Health keep unused code out of the system. This is an important thing. So the idea is, the last point, unwritten. TDD helps the unused code stay unwritten because they're focusing on requirements. Sometimes, you know, there's a tendency when you're writing code, you suddenly come with a great idea, if I do this, then it will take care of all those problems that may come in the future. Right. So that's a good, it could be good design, it could be good, it could be very nice design. But if you don't use it, let's not spend time on it. Makes code base more maintainable. We talk about that in patient testing. You already talked about that. So when you write the first test, then you write, and then you make it green, and then you make it then clean, refactor, if it means. And in pictorial form, that is test, code, refactor. Keep on going in that particular. There are three laws or rules of TDD, test-driven development. It's just formulation of what I have already talked about. You will not write any production code unless they have written a failing unit test first. And then you will not write more unit tests than is sufficient to fail. So you will not write like 10 tests all one by one. You write one test, immediately pass, second test, immediately pass, like that. And compilation failures are failure. So while writing some of the tests, if you encounter compilation failure, because if you're writing tests first, then the class that you're calling, the class doesn't exist. As soon as you type the class name, it's going to give you compilation error. So you fix those. And the third one is, you will not write more production code that is sufficient to pass the currently failing test. It might look, if you have not practiced this TDD, it might look a little counterproductive.
Can you please explain each one of these laws with an example?
We will work on that. The first one says, what we have been saying, first you have to run test, that will fail.
Is that code should be failed first with
the code should not exist.
Test should fail.
Yes. Write a test which should fail, and then you this particular thing says, you will write production code. So the purpose of writing production code should only be to pass a test.
Mm-hmm.
Right. So if you're all the tests are passing, don't write any more production code. First write a unit test. That's the next one. You will not write more of a unit test that is sufficient to fail. So this is, forget about the rules or laws, the idea is same. First, you write one unit test, which is failing, then write code to pass that, right? And then don't write more code. Then write some unit tests which will fail. It's a night motto. So it's a cycle. And at some point when you have, you know, progressively passed maybe 10 tests and you realize, you know, maybe I can refactor this code to make it more efficient.
So the purpose is to write the code to pass that unit test on.
Right.
Not to build up the functionality completely.
Exactly, exactly.
So suppose if I need to add, going back to that example of application form. So if I need to introduce a new frame of academic qualification of my applicant, and that might be holding some 10 more details of my applicant. So I will be writing for unit test for one field and then writing code based on that. Thank you. And I can write multiple unit tests for the same small area.
Right, so each method you may have multiple paths.
Supposing I am in that academic section, I have a drop down for graduation stream. So it's a drop down, and even while selecting another, it should be selecting a text box, which should not pass on any numerical value of any. So can we do multiple unit testing method and then write the code, or it is a strategy follow to pass the same one unit test?
Yeah, one test, write code, and
single.
Actually, usually what happens, I'll just give you a brief summary of what I've done in just a minute.
My purpose of asking such a question is just to understand the productivity also. Because
yeah, so usually what happens, unit tests are written by developers.
Mm-hmm.
That's a typical thing. Unit tests are
written
by developers, and because it's such a fast cycle, but it may happen that you have more testers in the team, or maybe in the beginning testers are three, or maybe some testers want to, they know, they have knowledge of Java, right, or C sharp, and maybe you want to experiment with pair programming, for example. If you need pair programming, you can create a relevant knowledge for the tester. So it could be a fixed cycle of one guy writing unit test, other guy writes code.
unit tests need to be written by developers.
The other test of service and those things. They are usually done by testers.
Unit testing done by
this is such a fast cycle, right? You write for maybe 2-3 minutes, the unit test, and then you pass it. You'll see that with example.
Okay.
Right, and then start with one example, and then you will have to carry on with the next. The most important. So test unit development. People look first. In the traditional approach to coding is you design something, you code it, and then you test it. And that could happen in a waterfall project where you design for 1 or 2 months, and then you code it for multiple months, and then you test it for multiple months, right? Or it could happen in the agile environment also, where it is story level, you design it, you code it, and then you test it. That is traditional approach. In test unit development, you start with testing something. You write test first, and because the code has not been written, so the test will fail. And then write code to pass this test. And then you see after writing this code, let's say you have written your test, 10 tests one by one, and you have passed all those tests. After passing each test, you'll see if there's a scope of improvement, you're refactoring or redesigning something. So that is the basic concept. So it reverses the cycle. And the benefit of, you know, in both of these approaches, you might end up with, you know, if you are, you know, professional programmers, you end up with working software. But if you follow this, the focus shifts from happy path development to focus on testing, which is acceptance criteria based testing. So when your focus shifts to testing, there are chances the code will be more maintainable and will be more robust. And you will also accumulate lots of unit tests that can be used for regression testing, automated regression testing. That was a basic example. these are three laws. The idea is same. You first, you will not write any production code unless you have written a unit test, and you will not write more unit tests unless you have some unit test which is failing. So the idea is not to write 10 unit tests, but write one unit test, make it fail, and then you write code to pass this. And the next one, you will not write more production code than is sufficient to pass the test. So after you have written one unit test which is failing, you write code to pass the unit test, and now don't go jump on to writing more code to pass future test. Wait, write the second unit test, and then code, pass the second unit test, and so on. Any question? For some misconceptions, writing code first and test is same as TDD. This is probably the next best possible thing for TDD, because not exactly TDD. And again, you could deliver, you know, successful software, working software, and maybe maintainable code for this one. So what this is saying is, if you write a method and then write all the unit tests, and then write second method, write all the tests, it might still work. It will still work. I mean, this is what people have been doing, and I personally did that for a long time, unless I kept it more for TDD. So it's still much better practice than, you know, not writing unit test at all and writing, you know, method which are hundreds of line long. So it will still give you a modular code, but it's not exactly as TDD. Because the focus over here again might go on to happy path coding rather than making the code, you know, making the code fail wherever it could in production.
Small question. So what does it exactly mean? Writing code first, then test is same as TDD?
This is a misconception. TDD isn't useful for designing architecture. So, like Agile, you must have heard about a term called emergent design. The design evolves. So this leaves that when you keep writing tests, and the third step was, you know, after testing and coding, the third step was refactor or redesign for design, right? So you keep refactoring. So the design evolves. Some people say that TDD, doing TDD means, you know, you're not thinking about architecture, you're not thinking about the higher level. So I'll try to bring you back on, you know, when we talked about acceptance testing. You have a story, you have one story, you have formed some idea about how you will implement that, right? So there is some level of design already going into that. But when you write actual code at the class level or method level, that doesn't use TDD. TDD does not mean that if you are given a story to implement, start writing, you just go there and start writing test code there. You need to do some thinking, right? And the thinking is more about very high level, rough layout design. And then when you actually start doing it, you evolve that architecture. It takes too much time. I think you covered that. It might take a little extra time in reading the first draft. But if you discuss
over time,
you'll go down. And not just the first one, the subsequent one. Because we are saying, right?
We are saving time of iteration.
Yes.
The iteration.
And after the first release, there will be enhancements, right?
Mm-hmm.
They will be faster because you have a regression suit, right? That you can learn automatically. And the example I was talking about where, you know, I was given this piece of code where multiple people from a, you know, reputed company, they had worked on that thing, smart people who had worked on it. And each feature was written different ways. In one case, the action classes were 2,000 lines long. In other one, the JSP was 1,500 long. So the first thing I had to do was somehow make it test, create the test suite and make it pass, because the code is already written, in that case it will pass, and then slowly start making changes and make sure none of the tests fail. In the first pass, it might take some extra time, but that is like an investment. It will help you forever. TDD is too complex to learn and implement. Is it too complex? You are still doing the same coding, right? If you are coding Java or .NET, your code is almost exactly the same thing. All you have to learn is JUnit or .NET is an engine, right? If you are already doing that in different fashion, and maybe you are not writing unit tests for all the methods, So it will force you to write unit tests for all the methods. But it's still the same technology. It's just a different discipline or more request discipline. TDD is only good for small projects. Any project that requires coding, any project that has classes or methods, right, you can use TDD over there. Any questions before we jump into the exercise part?
Just a simple question, how it is different from BDD?
So BDD is similar to ATDD, which is the functional level testing or black box testing, right? You're talking about feature level thing. For example, you write a unit for a web application, you write a test. When you request this particular finish on the screen, you have combo box or list box or regulation with this. Those are BDD.
But in that case also we write unit test cases.
Not unit tests. Those are behavior tests or you can say functional tests. So in functional tests you consider this entire system and then you talk about if I input this thing then what is the output, right? Function test, we can call it integration test. Yeah, so that's a black box test. This is a white box test. Any other questions? Anyone? Either you are understanding everything or. So let's build something now. Define a scope. What the exercise I have chosen for this thing is a string calculator where you pass something as a plus b or a minus b or a plus b minus c into the whatever long string calculator. Let's not discuss about the utility where it could be used and all. This is purely for this class, simple exercise. Simple that gets progressively complex. But first, let's define the scope. We have limited duration over here, about maybe 2 hours. So let's review this and I'll. Supported operators. Let's focus purely on plus, minus, division, and multiplication. Right? No ratio to power or square root and all things. I'm writing it here only. Arithmetic. Acceptable characters.
Alphabets.
Numbers.
Alphabet.
Only numbers and operators.
Okay.
Numbers and. What about decimal? You want to challenge yourself or you want to keep it simple?
Decimals.
What about brackets? Brackets will make it complex. So let's exclude brackets. What then? White space, do you allow white space? Next you're writing 4 plus 2. Do you can write 4 space plus space 2?
No space.
Max length of expression. No limit.
Yes.
How many?
10
operations. Is everybody comfortable with that?
5 operations.
So let's make it 4 or 5 and then we'll see if the same word can be used for 10 or more.
Right.
We'll begin small, so we'll begin with 2, don't worry. 5. here saying decimals. That what do you have to call?
Decimals.
Do we take out decimal for now?
Keep it.
Okay.
Including decimal four.
Including decimal? Fractions, decimals, so I think it's yes. Parentheses, we always said no. To start training. Some reminders, the cycle we are going to follow is test, code, refactor, and repeat until done. And we'll add features, feature layers one by one in small, manageable increments. And setup requires Eclipse 4. Eclipse for Java development, and people who have setup for .NET, they can do the same thing in .NET. And then team formation. We'll work on the team formation a little bit after doing this particular exercise. After the exercise, second, we can take a break.
Yeah.
And then we'll start. In the break, we can do all the
exercises.
And then we'll start like, with the exercise. Yeah. So I'll do the first bit. Let's do two little addition.
So we will do setup first or
break? I'll demo this one.
Okay, you demo this.
Yeah, this one I'll demo. So I'm taking the simplest one. Right, so you do the complex part later. Right. So I've created two packages. And there's no class over here. We'll begin with a unit test. Can you guys see it or is it too small? Test string calculator. Anybody familiar with the J unit here?
Or even an unit process, what is same?
So simple, so to test anything you say assert something, right? In J unit the syntax is assert equals, and assert equals is assert that these two things are equal.
There are multiple methods in .NET also,
yes.
I think the same will be
yes.
here.
It has all these methods.
Mm-hmm.
And we will
expected actual, then basis on the it will pass
right.
on our result and then pass or fail. When you run this test, it will say you will be failed.
Right. So the first one is expected. So expected is 6.0, and I'll pass 2 plus 4.
Yeah.
And the reason I'll put 6.0 not 6 is we are writing a generic method which will return as double. Double is for fraction, that's a single thing, because we are going to support it. Right? So this it is failing right now because we don't have
class.
This class. And we said compilation errors are errors. So we have successfully written one failed test. We create a string calculator class. Actually, I go into this one, it might create in the same package. So let me create a new class. So now the error is gone from here, interpreter. It's giving method one, evaluate. So we add the method, evaluate. So now it has the method, evaluate. Let me change it to return, double. Evaluate takes an expression. Returns 0.0. We are doing it. Alright. Okay. So with double the when it, the CPU does calculation, there sometimes there are very small errors, right? Float errors 0.0001. So you need to define that margin, error margin. For double comparison. So we create double margin for all, let's say 0.0001. This is our margin of error for our test. So if two numbers are within this particular range, we'll assume they are almost equal. Right. We need to pass that error margin. Now it is not saying it is deprecated. Simple test. Readable enough, assert equals expected value 6, and then you are passing an expression 2 plus 4, and the string calculator class is evaluating that, and this is the margin of error. That's from this. It's failing. Now we need to implement that. Any ideas? How to do it? This is the time to think about distributed design. How do we do it? Somebody is passing you a plus b and you need to calculate the value.
Define some variables in the table.
Okay. So first let's, and we are doing purely addition operations, so let's search for that character plus sign and see if it exists anywhere in the expression. Okay. Int os operator. Let me ask you this. If I just say return 6.0, it will run, right? Is it good or bad?
Right.
Why is it bad? Passing the test.
Yeah.
If you change your test to any other thing, it will fail again.
Yeah, so the, so even though you are writing code to fail to pass a test, you have to write generic code. You have to understand the requirement. The requirement is to add two numbers. The requirement is not to add 2 plus 4. If the requirement was to add 2 plus 4.
Taking parameter from that method and then accordingly to the calculation and then return
there. Right. So you have to write, generic code which is not just to pass a test, the idea is to pass similar kind of test, but write generic code. Okay. So post operator expression dot index of. So for .NET guys, I might be using some Java stuff. I think you will have equivalent .NET stuff. So this will give you the position of the plus sign. And then we check if pos operator is greater than 0. It could be at the first position also, but we are excluding it. If some number starts with, some expression starts with plus, right, we can ignore that plus. So looking 0 onwards. If all the portrays, or actually I should do it here, look for plus sign, first position onwards. If this is greater than 0,
then you calculate the left expression is expression dot substring starting from zero position to right expression is substring pause operator. Will you pause operator or pause operator plus one? Plus one. And until the end. So we have the
best expression of life.
That's the option. You don't need to touch this. That's better. To take until the end. So everything right so far? If you I might leave some errors in there, so just to make sure you're being watchful enough. And now let's return integer dot parse int. This is a Java parse a string as an integer. We use parse int. Left expression plus integer dot parse int right expression. And you return that. And if the code comes here, the expression of top being right. So we can throw an exception. We should return something like test evaluate. So any questions so far? We wrote a simple test, made it pass. Can you think of any more permutation combination of plus sign? Can we write this? Will it pass or fail?
It will fail. No, it will be extreme.
So it fails
because white is used a method there which is taking up the positions.
Yeah, because it has space and
yes.
Integer will give you a passing exception. So ideally, we probably should not be writing this thing because it is, we in the acceptance criteria, we said we are not going to support spaces.
Yes.
Right? So this should not be there, so if it supports, if it throws exception, that is perfectly fine. Okay. But if you want, we can take care of it now. You want to take care of it? You want to support spaces, white spaces?
Yes.
Should be a simple thing, right? So let's support spaces in all kind of white spaces, whether it's tab, new line, or anything in between. So how do we do it? Any ideas? We clean the expression right in the beginning. This expression dot replace all. There's a method in Java. The replace all, you specify what you need to replace. And in regular expressions, is there something equivalent in .NET for regular expressions?
Yes.
Okay. There is. So slash slash s is for white spaces, all kinds of white spaces. And you replace that with blank.
So what if I now, I don't know if it's a good thing or bad thing, what if we do one space to, and this should be equal to 16. Should it pass or fail?
It will pass.
It pass? Should it pass?
Yes, it should pass.
So we took a decision that any kind of white space, let it ignore completely. Right? If you want to complicate a design, we can do that, but again, to limit the scope of this particular exercise, let's completely ignore white spaces no matter where they happen. So even if you have it somewhere like this is tab in Java, and maybe in between you have a new line, and again, one and two tabs here, one space, and then in this space. So this should give you what? But what should it give you? It will fail now, right? Fail because this is 12 and this is
14.
It should be 26. So the test was wrong, now the test is right. You want to take it from there? Both of you to work a little bit more. Let's take it from there and see. I have up to, this is second step, I have up to 8 steps, and maybe today we will go up to 4 steps, 3 steps, but that's fine. The idea is progressively learn about the problem. Usually what happens if somebody gives you, you know, string calculator or some other problem in your project. It sounds simple, you have a general idea how to do it, but when you actually start doing it in a long term, then you realize the small challenges. For example, space over here, and there might be some other challenges we should encounter slowly. So we'll take a break, Saket.
Yeah.
And we'll, before the break, let's form teams of two, primarily because of two reasons. One is we don't have laptops, and the other thing is some people are not familiar with coding. And it also give you some idea about pair programming if you haven't done that. So all the people who have a laptop and who are proficient in one of the languages, Java or .NET, proficient enough, but they are not pretty complex. We can always discuss it. Somebody has a problem, we can discuss that. So who has laptop and who can code Java or .NET?
I have a laptop, but I don't code.
Do you have a setup installed? But you're going to pair with one of these, right?
So let's identify who can lead the pairing. Like how many people are they willing to lead the pairing sessions? So who feels that they can code and
we have four developers.
It's not.
So how many people can lead the code? So one, aapki kar lenge. Two,
three and four.
So I will do one, three, three. I can do it in
PHP.
Huh?
I can do it in PHP.
Same exercise. But in PHP, do you have
so we can have a three groups?
Unit testing?
No.
I can do in .NET, but I can try on Java.
Uh-huh.
It's not
More it's groups? Not three groups? Can someone more? Joy? You want to try? Paper
I'm doing this.
And computer is not a problem. Laptop is not a problem. Laptop is there. So you lead one group, eh? Four.
I can't put it in .NET or Java.
So what? You will learn.
So which language can you put
it? You will learn in the next thing.
No, one time. I put in detail.
Oh, okay.
Okay, so I can
also leave it.
Yeah, so like, okay. So we have about 3 plus 1, 4. 4 is group good enough. How many people get approximately 10 people?
Up to me, na?
So these three things will come.
Programming.
कोई नहीं ये तीनों में आ जाएंगे
लैपटॉप है ना एक के साथ
लैपटॉप तो है
तो तीन जने ये
और आप दोनों में हैं
आप आ जाओ
ये ज्वाइन करेंगे
ठीक
है सो हाउ मेनी टेबल्स वी हैव 1 2 3 4 एंड फोर ग्रुप्स सो ईच ग्रुप शुड हैव अ वन लीडर सो यू थ्री कैन फ्लाई वन एंड आई रिमेन ऑन माय सीट सो पीपल कैन ज्वाइन मी ओके मेक सेंस
एनी नोबडी इज वर्किंग इन जावा ना If you're working Java, I can give you this code, smaller code. But
I will try.
should go back to the previous one.
So break your step. And you can adjust. So one or two will join me and rest join. Once it is done, then you will mark out writing the first test.
First thing. Now, what is this project about? How to start? So we have created the project. Now, inside this, we need to add two packages. So just one test package and one code package. So package, we can consider it as a folder. So it's a folder where we will be putting our classes. So we can say, usually we write com dot say tdd dot code one thing and then tdd code dot then we add another package where we write a test. Add a package. This is something that just think com dot tdd dot test.
Done. So as of now we are done with our first story. जिसके अंदर केवल पैकेज बनाना था सो आवर एसेप्टेंस क्राइटेरिया वाज दैट ओपन द इक्लिप्स एंड क्रिएट टू पैकेजेस सो वी हैव अ सेंस ऑफ अचीवमेंट नाउ वी हैव अ सेंस ऑफ अचीवमेंट लेट्स राइट द फर्स्ट टेस्ट
Internally, or should I go for this?
talking, so he says,
एक ही से होना चाहिए, गलत बात है, बट लेट्स ट्राई
actually should, the way it should work is you have to divide 8 by 3.
So, why I'm saying, what example we can, that people who are interested, for example, can stay. I can just give a briefing about upcoming things, and somebody wants to leave.
Sure.
Yeah. And just remain connected using Twitter, or Twitter would be a good, Discuss Agile has a Twitter handle. So if you follow Discuss Agile on Twitter, then you will get a lot of updates.